This is Steve Downs, the voice of Master Chief, Sierra 117, and you're listening to Podcast Unlocked, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Now, finish this fight. Master Chief, out.
What's happening, friends? Welcome to Podcast Unlocked. It is IGN's weekly Xbox show, episode 611 here for September 6th. Yes, the unofficial game holiday slash fall season is upon us. There is a game called Starfield that has gone out wide today to Game Pass, to anywhere you want to buy it, anywhere you want to play it. And we've got plenty to talk about, although, you know, we did a whole hour and 20 minutes on Starfield last week. Stella's back, though. Stella Chung, good to see you.
Hello. Yes, I'm back from Gamescom and then immediately after PAX, which I did see some of you guys there, which it was very nice. It was so cool. Okay, first of all, thank you for recognizing me with the blonde. I was really worried about that. So it's very sweet. So I've been playing. I played about 5 hours of Starfield last night, and nice. It's better than what I thought it was going to be. But, you know, I know that people are saying that it gets better at like 10 hours.
Yeah, so five hours is nothing.
So I'm trying to get through that. It's definitely like all intro stuff, even at 5 hours, which was interesting. Yeah. But I did find some legendary weapons and stuff. And I may have gotten in trouble stealing a dog plushie, but like, you know, I am determined to become the plushie pirate.
Nice.
So I'm very excited for that. I just posted on Twitter the picture of like all the plushies sitting at a table together. So, I'm definitely going to wait till Destin's back for us to like really discuss, because he just got back from Gamescom. So, or like, you know, from his vacation and stuff. So we're going to do like a bigger opinion piece then on like what we think of the game so far. But yeah, I like exploding things in the game. That's fun.
Yeah, there's we need to give you a week to really get into it and get going. I mean, I haven't been able to play as much as I would have liked since the last episode, but I did finally finish the Crimson Fleet whole entire quest line.
Oh.
It probably took me, I mean, that was probably a 12 to 14 hour quest line just by itself. Just that entire faction quest line. And I loved it. Like, I loved that quest line. Now last night I finished it and then just selected. I went back to highlight the main constellation quest line in my quest log, and I haven't even, and I just saved and quit and went to bed there. So it's the first time I've gone back to the main quest since hour one of the game, because I told my whole story last week. You weren't here. I accidentally got into the whole Crimson Fleet piracy quest line hitting the wrong button in a bar when I was talking to a bartender. I accidentally clicked in my right stick and it melee attacked the bartender and they called the cops and it turned into a whole thing.
Ryan!
But it was, like I said, I've had a blast with it that entire faction quest line the last like 12, 14 hours. So I do love that. I mean, that's always been the best part of Bethesda's RPGs for me, is the faction. I mean, everybody remembers the Dark Brotherhood quest line from Oblivion, and there have just been so many good ones in their games over the years. So now I'm going to go back to the main quest line and see like what I'm actually supposed to be doing in this video game. But yeah, eager to hear more after you get to play a bunch more, and from Destin when he's back next week. Because it sounds like both of you got some sort of undetermined, maybe we'll find out if it's COVID bug during your travels.
Yeah. So far, tests are negative, which is great. But yeah, we'll see.
Yeah. I can hear it. I can hear it a little bit in your voice, having just come off of it myself. So appreciate you being here, because I know, you know, when you're under the weather, talking for an hour is not necessarily the most physically enjoyable thing that you could be doing. And yeah, so we'll welcome Destin back for the same sickness reason next week too. He wasn't quite up to getting on the show with us today, which I completely understand, having just gone through it. A quick bite of news, little appetizer here before we get into our main topics. Yesterday, you know, we record on Wednesdays, of course. Replaced, and the developer of that game, Sad Cat Studios, they posted a message to Twitter confirming that they are not going to make 2023 as far as a release date with their game. They say, first of all, we have to admit game development is hard. It's also rewarding in its own right. but mostly it's just hard. We would like to pay our respects to every team who delivers their project, no matter how small or big it is. It's a tremendous achievement. Let me skim through here because there was, they basically just said, hey, you know, we're not gonna sell ourselves short and ship it now when it's not quite ready to go. So they're taking a bit more time, and thank you to our super producer Red, if you're watching on video, for putting some trailer footage up on screen, because you know we kind of all need a little reminder on why we're super excited about this game, which is a console exclusive on Xbox. You know, this is a like a pixel art Blade Runner. I mean, just look at the lighting in this. Actually, Khalif, you know, I haven't really gotten to talk to you about this game. Like, what? Where is this on your sort of hype meter?
I mean, it's really high. There was another game that was spoken about some years ago that game. Those two games were super high on my list in terms of seeing that kind of art form, that 2.5D perspective, kind of side-scrolling shooter kind of make its move. And now both of them are, you know, one is probably indefinitely delayed. We haven't heard anything about the previous one for a very long time. But now seeing that replace is not going to make 2023, it makes me a little sad. But again, it's not like we don't have things to play this year.
Exactly. You know what I mean? Right? There's no, I can't imagine anybody in the Xbox community is complaining about this delay. We just got Starfield. We're going to talk in a minute about how we're going to have Baldur's Gate at 3 in the next 3 months. Like, there's Forza Motorsport comes out in a month from now. So right. Yeah, we're not exactly hurting for fun stuff to play.
Yeah, I think the extra layers of polish again for a game like this, and again, it just tells you not only again just how hard it is to make games, but how quickly you have to pivot once you don't really see it kind of hitting your initial time frame. Yeah. But I'm really excited for stuff like this. I think again, we have this conversation about the breadth and depth of the Xbox catalog, and having games like this in there, knowing that it's coming, knowing that it's going to be probably a banger. I'm just hyped for that kind of stuff. I want to see more of it kind of come to the platforms. That's dope.
Yeah, and if we now look ahead a little bit, I know, you know, as gamers, we need to we try to enjoy the moment, but we can't help but look ahead a little bit to what the next thing is. But now, you know, with Replaced totally confirmed for next year, I mean, I think we all would have guessed it at this point because it's September 6th as we record. They probably, if they hadn't announced a release date by now, they probably weren't going to make this year, and that's okay. So now that we know we got Replaced next year, we don't know quite when, but what we do know is Stalker 2 is in Q1, as I think we mentioned on either last week's show or the week before. So Stalker 2, we've got Replaced, we've got Hellblade 2, and Avowed. Like, those are four very different exclusives, all Xbox exclusives. You've got a AAA first-person shooter. You've got the, as you well put it, Ka, the, you know, 2.5D pixel art Blade Runner kind of noir action adventure game from a smaller team. You've got Hellblade 2, which is your sort of classic third-person, highly polished narrative psychological horror adventure. And then Avowed as a big first-person open-world role-playing game. So, you know, there will no doubt be more that comes to Xbox on an just talking exclusively next year. But those four right there, Stella, line up. I mean, that's got the outline of a nice year to look forward to already for next year for Xbox.
Yeah, no, it's great. I feel like we were just talking about how there aren't enough games coming out for Xbox, but now here they all are, the ones that we wanted, and they're all coming out. So I'm very excited for next year. This year, I feel like we're at a cap. Please stop. I have enough time. I am barely getting by on I feel like I'm putting in all my hours on like all the different games, but it's like never enough because I'm just like, oh, I have to split up all this time. I refuse to be a backlog gamer any more than I am. And it's becoming really hard not to be. So I feel really good about the games coming out. I'm so sad I didn't have time to play Stalker 2 when I was at Gamescom because it was just so busy, but very excited for that one. And I know I keep talking about that, but also seeing Replaced again, I'm like, oh yeah, this looks so good. It looks so story rich. I am so excited for it. So yeah, next year I'm excited, but I'm going to work through everything. And then as they come out, I'll play it, which is why I'm like not that upset that Replaced has gotten delayed. It's fine.
Yeah. Yeah, Destin did get to play Stalker 2, so once he gets back next week, we'll make sure to get the report from him. Yeah, I mean, you're right about this year. What a 2022 versus 2023, talk about opposite sides mm-hmm. of the spectrum. You know, this time last year, we were begging for anything. Like, throw us a freaking bone here, people. You know, where it's just like, come on, anything. And now this year, you weren't even joking when you were like, please stop. That's enough video games. Because, I mean, just right now, the Monkey Island, Legend of Monkey Island, Tall Tales, and Sea of Thieves, that's made for me. And I haven't played more than the little snippet of the first one that I got to play as a pre-release thing. So I've got that that I really want to get to. I have, Sea of Stars looks awesome. I backed that on Kickstarter years ago. It's in Game Pass, and I got a Steam code for my probably use on the Steam Deck because I had backed it on Kickstarter like 3 or 4 years ago. So you've got that. I mean, but, you know, any gaming time I have is going to the game behind me, to Starfield, because it's not a small video game. And Forza Motorsport is looming, and it's like, well, I wonder how much, like, am I even going to be, will I have even dented Starfield by the time Forza shows up in a month? And I'm not so sure, but we're eating good right now, and the the forecast is looking really nice already, without really knowing anything about 2024 for Xbox, or at least not knowing much. And one of those games, which I alluded to a moment ago, we got to start here because this is what we were calling for. This actually is a bit of old news, but we didn't get a chance to talk about it since we were all Starfield all the time last week. But this is a huge story that we've got to circle back on. I was among many people. I mean, on this show, I called for it, and plenty of people in the community did the same, calling on Phil Spencer and Xbox leadership to drop the parity requirement between Xbox Series X and Series S so that we could get Baldur's Gate 3, by all accounts, an absolutely tremendous video game onto the Xbox platform, because it's not a PlayStation exclusive. It's just been hung up because of the split screen on the Series S. Well, kudos to Phil Spencer and to the Xbox leadership team. They have done exactly that. They have bent the rules exactly as I hoped they would and thought eventually they would. So here we are, just shy of 3 years into the new generation. We have the first exception to the rules being made. The studio head at Larian saying on Twitter, super happy to confirm that after meeting with Phil Spencer, we found a solution that allows us to bring Baldur's Gate 3 to Xbox players this year still, something we've been working towards for quite some time. His name is Sven Vinke. He went on to explain the situation, saying that Xbox Series X will have the split screen feature, while the Series S simply won't get split screen. However, all the hot fixes, all the improvements, patches will be, of course, in the Xbox version, as you would expect. And there will be cross-save progression between the Steam and Xbox Series version. So if you've already bought it on your PC on Steam and you want to move over and continue it on your console on the couch, you will be able to do that. So that's nice to have as well. So Khalif, let me go to you first here, just getting the reaction. This is obviously a welcome thing. Are you surprised that the rules were bent? What's your thought here?
Not surprised. I mean, I think the biggest takeaway from this for me is that studios trying to make games are always going through processes of trying to figure out the best ways to tune those for the hardware. Phil has done exactly what he needed to do from a company and public persona and from a, you know, let's make sure gamers are happy perspective by getting one of the biggest games of the year on the platform where people were asking for it. And I think fans also then get a chance to now think a little bit more about the development process, right? Where it's not that easy, just like, just fix it conversation that we see happen all the time. It's more of how do you work with partners who are, you know, not necessarily first party ones to make sure that they're getting the proper support that they need to be able to make the games on your platform that you want to see happen there. So I think it's a lot of different angles to this that I think are going to be interesting. The one other thing that I thought was kind of was funny was somebody was trolling the other day about seeing someone shared some data. He had done a little bit of testing and was like, the game is running at 21 frames per second in split screen. And then if you actually looked at the video, they're like, no, it's pretty stable, 30 frames per second across X and S here. But it is the always the like one-upsmanship in the community of like, well, why didn't you see why this thing isn't working right? But it is actually working right. It's funny to see those warring factions continue to have their say in the mix when the actual information is that it runs pretty well, even on the S, which is something that people were hoping for. So good job, Phil, and the rest of the team. Like getting that job done was probably not easy. And it takes a little bit of time to make that happen, but they got it done. That's good.
Yeah, Stella, your thoughts here. Baldur's Gate 3 on Xbox.
Yeah, the more the merrier. Please play this so I can talk to you about this because, oh my God, I love this game. It is so good. There's so many different options. And if you need help making a character, hit me up. I can help you because it gets very overwhelming very quickly. I love that the older I get, the more I decide to branch out into different games. And I never was into turn-based combat. But now I'm just like, oh, maybe I can be. For the right story, I can be. So for this one, it's very good. Hours and hours of playtime. Again, if you're playing Starfield, finish that. I want to say commit to a big game that you're playing right now because you will not finish it if you start another one. But yeah, I'm very glad that they were able to do this. It was so funny. I saw this update and I was like, Ryan, they literally did what we said to do. And I was like, they listened. So very happy about that. Always super happy to have more gamers on a game that I'm playing. And because like, yeah, I want to talk about this all the time. So very happy about this. Very horny game. So, you know. Do with that one.
Yeah, you were Twitch streaming. you were streaming, showing off. You had like multiple private part options going on your
character. No.
There's a whole thing going on. There's game three.
Okay, it was really funny. I used my webcam. I moved it over my character's private parts, but then my chat. I just see boobs, and I was like, oh no, I forgot the top half. So yeah, I flashed my stream. So just be aware of that.
Oh man. Khalif, I don't know if any bells went off in your head when Stella was talking about that it turns out she can get into a turn-based RPG with the right story. I think, Stella, after you complete Starfield and Baldur's Gate 3, which, you know, maybe so next year sometime, given how huge these games are, but there's a game you should play now that you have opened your world up to turn-based combat with a great mm-hmm. story and in a role-playing game. And it's a little video game from the original Xbox called Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic.
That's the game that also made me get into it because I finished the first one.
Oh, you did?
I have the second one on Steam, and I have all the mods. But again, I am playing through all of these other games
because
I was originally going to play it. Yeah, I bought that on, I know people are going to come after me, but I bought that on Switch because it was like $10. I was like, oh, why not? This is good. Because I don't have a Steam Deck yet. And I was playing it, and I was like, oh, no, this is good. Why do I like this? Because I never expected to like that sort of combat. But I was like, no, this is really fun.
Yeah, I'm kind of similar. You know, I don't love turn-based combat. I've never really been a JRPG fan. Yes. I've preferred Western RPGs mostly because the combat, you know, more often than not is not necessarily turn-based. But yeah, KOTOR had me pausing the action and queuing up attacks and get, man, that just such good memories of that game.
Yes.
So I'm glad you've already played it. That's it's a good recommendation for our audience though, especially the younger audience. If you are going to play Baldur's Gate 3 on Xbox and you do get super into it and you're like, hey, turn-based combat, it's cool. Yes. Go back and play KOTOR, which you can still buy on the store, on the Xbox mm-hmm. storefront. I believe it's, unless it's gone on sale, which if it has, great. But I believe it's just $10. Yeah, digital exactly. download. It's backwards. You can play it on your Series X or Series S or Xbox One. And yeah, KOTOR, one of the greats. But
it holds up really well, but save every moment you get because it does not autosave for you. And I promise you, you will end up regretting that.
It's a 20-year-old game, so yeah. checkpointing was not sort of the norm the way it is now. Like I will give Starfield a lot of credit for that. Like it throws down autosaves and like it saves a lot. So if you do screw something up or kind of get into a point of where you respawn and you're just in a bad way, you can back up without having to lose too much progress, which I do appreciate. Because when I was in the end sequence of the or about near the end sequence of the Crimson Fleet faction quest line last night, there was kind of a gauntlet to be run through. I had to take advantage of those sometimes, like, oh, I need to back up a little further here just to take another cleaner shot at this.
It's like a Forza rewind button.
Kind of, yeah. They're not wrong. So I guess the last note on Baldur's Gate 3, again, you heard it from the head of Larian Studios. We will be getting it this year. So as soon as they can kind of land on a date where they know they're going to be clearing certification and ready to ship it on presumably the latest build, you know, after whatever next big patch is coming, we'll certainly pass that date along. But you know, is it going to be October? Maybe November probably seems like the safer bet, just because we know they're still working on this. Could it slip to December? Absolutely, but it does seem like we are going to have that in the next 3 months here. Which is great news. And they did say later that the Series S might still get split screen later. It is something they're gonna try to work on, but they're not making any promises on that. So yay for Baldur's Gate 3 on its way. Starfield is here now. But I want to go back in time a little bit to Gamescom. Of course, Stella, you were there, Destin was there, and I'm bummed that Destin's not here to he should be the one to talk us through this because he did this. But if you haven't seen it, Destin got a big sit-down interview with Phil Spencer at Gamescom, which is well worth a read, well worth a watch, however you'd like to consume it. And I want to go through a few different nuggets, a few different sections of this that are worth talking about. And I want to start with Phil Spencer's thoughts on potentially bringing Call of Duty and other Activision Blizzard games to Game Pass. So I thought Destin did a great job asking just good direct questions that gamers want to know. And Phil said, I want to make sure people know that there's work to actually move games to Game Pass. So for the people who think the deal is going to close and then everything's available, that's not true. And it hasn't been true in other acquisitions that we've done. There's work for us to go do, just mechanical work for us to go do. So it'll take us time, definitely time, to get the games in the portfolio. And then later, so it was kind of like, well, there was the idea that Bobby Kotick, the current CEO of Activision Blizzard, who I do not think will survive the transition, and quite frankly, I hope he does not, Destin followed up about that. Well, hey, what about Bobby Kotick saying that he's not a big fan of putting Call of Duty into a subscription service? Phil Spencer laughed when asked how he'd handle those different ideologies when the deal closes. He says, quote, well, there's a different person making the decisions. He laughed, referring, of course, to himself in that scenario. On Game Pass, it's not necessarily true that every game looks at Game Pass and says, that's the opportunity for me. If you're a massively successful AAA franchise that has double-digit million marketing budget to go drive awareness and discovery of your game on day one, and that's part of your model, I totally understand why you wouldn't window your game day one into a subscription. We've got no issue with that. We do it as a first party because we're trying to grow the subscription, and we're looking at the overall health of the subscription as an outcome. We love that. We see it grow on console, more growth on PC, definitely now, which has been awesome, especially as he was taking in the sights and sounds of Gamescom. So the quote kind of continues, but that's the real gist of it. So let me come back to this, Khalif. I'll start with this. First of all, do you think that the maybe world's least, the gaming world's least loved CEO, Bobby Kotick, do you think he will be shown the door by Mr. Spencer once this deal finally closes?
And the internet and the gods and the earths and everybody else on the universe will be like, get him out of here. It'll be really interesting. It was also really nice to hear Phil have that moment with Destin, because that was like his Vince McMahon gif moment where he gets to walk through with the elbows out, which is kind of nice. Like, no, I'm running this, and this is the way we're gonna do this. I think Bobby will probably not make the transition. He'll get a nice golden parachute, and then he'll go to Tahiti and hang out with NBA stars. He'll do that thing. But it'll be one of those things where I think I really appreciate also kind of Phil giving us a little bit of behind the curtains there, where the conversation does become one in which you do talk about the different scenarios of why you would want to bring your game to Game Pass and maybe why you wouldn't. Again, it is a thing to grow not only the player base of a game, but get visibility out there early on for games that are potentially maybe not going to have a big, strong audience in that way, and a way to kind of also give, again, fans and players another access point to the greater conversation that Phil has and the rest of the Xbox team has talked about over the past 5 to 6 years, which is we want you to have games wherever you play. Wherever you find that device that you're using, it then becomes another access point for you to be able to play these things in that way. It does make me think, though, for a game as big as Call of Duty, what would that look like for a Game Pass release, right? Where it's already huge, it's already got a ridiculous player base in terms of numbers. Does that make that even grow even more than we've already seen? Is that a thing that people who are, you know, kind of the annual purchasers of a game like Call of Duty, does that make them want to dig in and say, well, if I'm already in Game Pass and I'm going to get this game that I know I'm going to play already, does that just save me more money to spend on DLC and microtransactions in the game? Like, how does that play into the conversation for you as a player if you're seeing a game that big in the ecosystem? That's super. I want someone to do that math for me so I can kind of understand what that means for the greater conversation. And does that actually give more people the want to jump on Game Pass in a way that they haven't done before?
Well, that's where I think that's the real question is do you... Does the number of people you drive to Game Pass, is that greater than just continuing to sell the game outside of Game Pass because you know that an eight-figure number of people are going to buy it every single year? Like, that's
right.
Somebody, there are data, very well-paid, highly educated data analysts at Microsoft that are, I'm sure, have run those numbers over and over again and are trying to figure out the exact, you know, best way to monetize it while hopefully not like trying to take advantage of customers or you know, or anything like that. So yeah, I don't really know the answer to that. Stella, your thoughts on on Activision Blizzard games, Call of Duty or otherwise, potentially making their way to Game Pass down the road?
I think it would be very smart. A lot of people nowadays are just like, oh my God, $70 games, especially a $70 Call of Duty game that a lot of people would not otherwise play. And of course, Warzone is still going to be free, which is great. And I know a lot of people who play Warzone because it's a free-to-play game. They get to play with their friends. But a lot of times there are some really cool events and really cool things that come to multiplayer, and you need the full game to even play that. So I feel like a lot of people are going to be like, oh, I'm tired of Warzone. Let's go to multiplayer where you can, like, you know, die, come back, die, come back, you know, that fast-paced Call of Duty thing. And I think people are going to like that, and they're probably going to actually download the full game and play the campaign. Now there are raids in the campaign mode that you can't play unless you have the actual campaign. So that sucks. So it's one of those things of, like, I definitely think that it's going to... Oh, hey, this is my multiplayer review. Cool. I think it's going to be one of those things where the audience is definitely going to grow. I'm going to be able to get a lot of my friends into this because they're like, well, I can't justify the price for me. Yeah. But this is definitely going to get people into the waters. And then I think potentially they might even buy older titles. And also, let me tell you, the Battle.net UI for playing Warzone is ass right now. It is so bad. Like, you have to do Modern Warfare. You have to play, it's Call of Duty that you download. It's just Call of Duty. And I was so worried because I was like, where did my Warzone go? Where did all this stuff go? They consolidated it. So I would totally trust Game Pass to make it very apparent what game you're playing, because they want you to know, hey, this you would not have without Game Pass. So it's, I think they would do a pretty good job of that. Again, audience would grow very much, which I think would be very fun and very cool. More people would be able to experience new Call of Duties that they otherwise would not, especially since they release so often. And, you know, you still have your season passes and battle passes and everything. So they're going to get more money, because the more people play, the more they're like, oh, that person has a really cool skin. And I'm playing with my friend all the time. Why not just throw $10 one time, one season? Yeah. You know, so it's going to be one of those things of, this is going to generate FOMO and players are going to buy more into it. So I think it's very smart of them, and they're going to generate, they're going to be fine. You know, they're going to be okay.
Yeah, well said. I mean, that, because for me, I'm, you all know how much I love Diablo 4. That, like, Diablo 4 to me as a service game makes a ton of sense to put onto Game Pass, because we just heard there was a new interview with Rod Ferguson this, and he said that the plan is for there to be a full proper expansion every year. And we know they have their battle pass, they have their seasons of content. So that's one where I could see, I mean, particularly since Diablo 4, by the time this deal closes, will have been out for some number of months, where throw Diablo 4 into Game Pass, you bring in a ton of new players, and speaking from personal experience, Diablo 4 will hook you really fast. It is not a slow burn in Diablo 4. You will get right in and you will immediately get it, be feeling the narcotic like pull of that that grind of that combat loop. And you'll spend money on the battle pass and on the expansion. So, but Call of Duty being that unicorn that it is, I'm genuinely not convinced. I'm really uncertain as to whether Microsoft would put Call of Duty into Game Pass on day one. I think absolutely they'd put it in after maybe 3 months at the most, like, you know, because those first 3 months, we know from NPD, it does sell all year. Like, Call of Duty has legs every year and it does continue to sell. But I could see where maybe like after this turn of the new, you know, if it comes out in October, or in this case, this year, early November, maybe sometime early in the following year, it goes into Game Pass after everybody's kind of bought it. And you got that FOMO factor that you're both talking about. But I'm not sure if they're going to want to turn down the guaranteed $70 game purchases that they know they're going to get on day one.
Here's a quick question for both of you too. I think the thinking in here, you talk about Diablo in this way, and tell me if I'm wrong. I don't think there are a ton of games as service games on Game Pass currently. If I'm thinking about that and kind of like rolling through the games in my head, the question I have for both of you is, with a game like Call of Duty in the mix and Diablo doing fairly well, do you think with games as service having this kind of weird feeling in the gaming community where it kind of has a kind of negative specter around it, could a game coming to Game Pass as big as Call of Duty or something maybe going day and date and having a successful run, does that maybe change the sentiment around the idea around games as service, because you're kind of weirdly inceptioning service within a service kind of stuff? Do you feel like that? Can you wind up cutting off that initial hit and that initial hurt of the financial layer there by saying you got this game, but now you can enjoy all the other stuff you might not have spent money on? Maybe.
I mean, Valorant is a live service game, and that's on Game Pass now. Same with other live service Riot games, which, honest, if I'm being honest, they do not need Microsoft's platform. They are doing just fine.
Elder Scrolls Online comes to mind for me.
So we're very different. That's so funny. I immediately go to like FPS and you're just like, hello.
MMO. I love this RPG.
It's so funny. No, totally. I think it definitely does get rid of that, like, oh, it's here. Sure. Why not? Right. And you, with Valorant and the Riot games, you can get some of the characters that you otherwise would not have been able to get, which is nice. So you do get that. And that does kind of lower the barrier to entry for a lot of people. I don't know about Elder Scrolls Online, so I'll let Ryan talk about that. But.
Well, you made all great points. The thing, actually, I'm gonna just pivot a little, because Kyle, when you said that, it made me actually come up with a kind of counter argument to my own point from a minute ago about not being sure if Call of Duty would go into Game Pass on day one. You know, one thought that might be a reason why Microsoft would want to put it into Game Pass on day one is, and tell me if either of you disagree, because I'm not thinking this through yet. I'm just kind of thinking through it in real time. But I wonder if Call of Duty day one Game Pass could have a very positive gravitational effect, meaning if Call of Duty's there on day one, it's going to pull in a ton of subscribers. Meaning if you're another publisher, you're going to want your game in Game Pass, because sure, those people they're going to be playing Call of Duty, but it makes your game a lot easier for that player to maybe, you know, fire up and check out, because they've subscribed. They've Call of Duty has sucked them in to the subscription, and another publisher might go, well, yeah, you know what? I want to get in on Game Pass too, because with all these people in there for Call of Duty, it gives my game a better chance of being seen, of being downloaded, of being tried out, and ultimately of having money spent within it. Am I off base here? Am I making sense, Khalif?
I think it could work in that way, depending upon how things are viewed on the store. Like, you know, if your game that you decided to throw into, you know, you decided that you were going to say, Microsoft, we need some help with our marketing. We're gonna forego the initial upfront sales that we might get so that we can get prime placement in the store, and that placement is super visible. Then that makes a ton of sense for you, because then you're not only, like you said, up against and next to all of these other bigger titles, but then you do have that potential kind of, you know, waterfall effect of people checking out your stuff in that way too. So I think it would probably really depend on the numbers. It really depends on where the current visibility is with the store, but it could be something really interesting. I'd love to see someone who's maybe done that, and because I'm sure that's happened at some point with some game that was like, this just makes sense because there's a lot of buzz right now around the service. We should be here. I wonder if that makes some sense. Yeah, so that makes sense. Stella?
Yeah. I mean, I think Starfield's like that, right? A lot of people are like, I don't know if that's not my kind of game. And, you know, they're like, oh, it's on Game Pass in a few days. Sure, why not? And of course, there's that FOMO of like people being able to play early if you upgraded, which again, a lot of people forget that if you have Game Pass, you also get a discount on actually purchasing those games off of that app, which is great. So, you know, you could upgrade for like $30. You're just like, oh my God, yeah, absolutely. So there's going to be things like that too, especially since Call of Duty does have that thing where you can play early if you pre-order. And I think Xbox will most likely do a deal like that on their platform as well, so you can own the game. And then on top of that, you're also going to buy seasonal updates and stuff like that. So even if it drops day one, I think it'll do great numbers. And also the amount of times people forget to unsubscribe from monthly things, sure. You know? Yep. I mean, they're also going to be counting on that, right?
Yeah, the streaming services literally bank on that from all of us all the time. All the time that happens. So,
yeah, good point.
Well, we'll see what shakes out there. Now I kind of want to, everybody listening is going, well, when are you going to talk about the thing, the headline topic, the reason that I wanted to hear this? When are you going to talk about the mid-gen refresh? Let's talk about that now, because there are a couple more topics I want to get to. So let's get to our headline topic. So Destin asked Phil, again, great question, and Phil answered, I'll leave how you feel about his answer up to both you two as panelists and to our listeners. Do you have any news about some sort of mid-generation refresh for Xbox? And obviously, Phil's not going to make a product announcement right then and there on the IGN stage, although he's welcome to do so anytime. We invite him to do that. But here was Phil's answer, and I want to get each of your thoughts on this. Phil says, no, we're doing right now the increased storage on the Series S. But no, like I said, we're kind of at the end of the beginning in my mind. So I think we need to let developers settle on this hardware and get the most out of it. But in terms of increased frame rate, increased resolution, I just look at what goes on with on PC with high-end GPUs, high-end CPU, and it's not always just about pixel count or frame resolution. I think there's lighting techniques. There's a bunch of things that go into what makes a game look and feel great, and we have a ton of headroom as an industry there. Stell, I'll go to you first. So he's at the, I think the most generous way you could interpret that is that there won't be a mid-gen refresh for at least the next couple of years, and you could potentially interpret that as there not being one at all. What are your thoughts?
Mm-hmm. I think I agree with Phil. I mean, they have a lot of headroom, yes, because I feel like the industry wasn't ready for this generation yet, because I feel like we are just now getting up to date with all the technology that the modern consoles have to offer, and we're just like, okay, I think developers are finally, because obviously it came at a time when like the pandemic hit, right? So it's like, okay, they're finally able to get back into the flow of things. They're finally able to test the hardware that we have now. So it doesn't even feel like mid-generation, honestly. It feels like we're like at the beginning. So it's one of those things of like, yeah, no, they need more time with it. We just haven't had more time. And I think Baldur's Gate is a really good telling point of that. Because like even with the PS5, they're doing the early access. They're testing everything, seeing what they can max out. Same with like the Series S and X. And I think developers just need a lot more time with this. And it's great. I love that Phil is actually acknowledging that they have a lot of more space that they can do with the Series X. And I'm like, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. We lost like 2 years to the pandemic. We need those 2 years back, and we're just now catching up. So, yeah.
Kana, your thoughts?
Yeah, and, you know, bouncing and piggybacking off of what Stella said perfectly, I think the thing that we've always seen, and this has not been a new revelation to anyone who's been watching video games over the past decade, has been everything gets really, really dope towards the end of the generation. And also, it would be a marketing head. It would just be like the worst thing that marketing could do right now for Xbox when they've gotten some good graces back, is to now throw a new version of hardware while also a huge part of the fan base, as I've had a ton of arguments on Twitter the past 72 hours about what the hardware can do versus can't do, what the expectations should be from the player base and from the community. And hearing conversations about how folks who are very, you know, learned in the community still get the technology wrong and trying to make that work, that's just a logistics nightmare for marketing to have to redo all of that work. And then you piggyback that off of all the new things that devs are going to have to work into the pipeline to get things to work. We saw, again, the conversation with Larian and the struggles that they had getting, you know, split screen on the S and on the X and all that. You just make that infinitely harder for the folks who are developing games to make sure that you have that platform parity if you're going to keep the parity clause in there. So smart for him to talk about that and you know, not give that away. If they're even working on something that's, you know, a smaller form factor, maybe would be nice for some stuff, like chunking all the goodness that you have in next in an even smaller box. But messing with the innards of that console right now, you're just going to cause chaos in these streets. It'll be people not knowing what to do with themselves and fussing about how games aren't supposed to get made on these consoles. So.
So, okay, so you're not even looking for it. I'm torn on it, honestly, because,
yeah.
I mean, as both of you have well described, all signs point to there either not being a mid-gen refresh at all, or this generation is just going to get extended way out, and the mid-gen refresh will come later. Although, I believe, and a commenter will probably know this instantaneously, this is a thinking extemporaneously thing. Wasn't there something in the court testimony when Phil was on the stand and all that stuff, where didn't we kind of get a vague idea that it 2028 was going to be the next Xbox? I feel like, all right, I'm seeing nodding. Yeah, I think I'm remembering that correctly, that there was some sort of indication that maybe that was the plan. And that's certainly what we all would have guessed anyway. I mean, these launched
yes.
in a 28-year dev cycle. It was, right. 7 years for the Xbox One generation, 8 years for the 360 generation. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, 2028 seems right. But we know we have price increases that have happened for the first time ever. That is not indicative of a mid-gen refresh coming along at any time soon. We have the cost of the consoles is usually reduced over the first few years, which is often, as you noted, Khalif, reflected in us getting a slim, a smaller form factor, cheaper to manufacture box from the hardware manufacturer, and we haven't seen that yet. And then, Stella, your point about this generation really only just now getting rolling because of the 2 years that all of us, developers, players alike, lost to the pandemic. I don't know. I really thought that after the Xbox One X and the PS4 Pro last gen, I thought this whole mid-gen refresh thing was here to stay forever. I thought that was going to be a new normal. But, you think about it too, and Phil kind of alluded to this in his answer to Destin, there's no 8K to go to, right? We're not going to 8K, right? Like with the One X, we went from the Xbox One being a 1080p machine to there was a real obvious, to your point, Cop, marketable thing with the One X where play your Xbox One games in 4K with this machine. Right. A mid-gen refresh now isn't going to do that. It's not that there wouldn't be improvements. You'd get 4K 60 more reliably with a mid, maybe like Starfield could potentially be 4K 60 on a Xbox Series X Pro or Series XX, whatever you want to call it. But yeah, there just isn't going to be that obvious thing. Like, I know ray tracing is something that the machine's capable of. We haven't really seen too much of it because we've learned it's got a lot of, it sort of costs a lot in terms of dev resources. So yeah, I thought Phil gave a fair answer there without explicitly, I mean, he's Phil. You kind of have to learn to, you have to learn to speak Phil because he, being the CEO of a multi-billion dollar division of a trillion dollar company, he kind of can't often just come right out and go, yes, we're going to do a mid-gen refresh. He would never say that in an interview like that. So yeah, I've gone from being certain that we would get a mid-gen refresh at the start of this generation, pandemic or not, to now I would lean towards doubtful. I'm not convinced it won't happen, but I'm no longer super optimistic that it will.
Here's another thing. Go ahead, Stella. Go ahead.
I was just going to talk about so we were seeing, if you were watching on YouTube, like the video version, we were cycling through the different trailers that boasted, 4K, 120, up to 120 FPS. We have not gotten any games that can consistently do 60 FPS. And I was curious. I was like, how many of the games on the Xbox Series can currently support 120 FPS? It doesn't mean that they can be, right? It just means that they can support it. So
you meant 120 earlier, not 60, right? You're talking about 120.
Yeah, 120, 120. Yeah, because the trailer is all set up to 120. So it's like a lot of the older games, like Battlefield 1, 4, Hardline, Borderlands 3, Call of Duty Black Ops, Cold War, Modern Warfare, Warzone, which is great. But I haven't seen people say that they've gotten to 120. So if you have, please let me know, because that's huge. Doom Eternal. The Halo Master Chief Collection, which I have not tested that. I wouldn't put it past it because it is an older game, so absolutely. Apparently Halo Infinite as well, but I have not seen that. Yeah, can you run that at 120? Have you tried?
I think so.
You think so?
Yeah,
okay.
Not positive.
Yeah, but I see things like Mirror's Edge Catalyst, Overcooked 2, Resident Evil 7. So it's a lot of these games and Titanfall 2, of course. Yes.
Older stuff.
Yeah, it's a lot of older stuff. So I feel like, we're fine. When Phil says that they have a lot of headroom, they mean it, because I don't think, like, Starfield doesn't run at 120. It doesn't support up to 120. So I'm just like, there can be so many updates to all of these games that came out this year, last year, that make them utilize the full capabilities of the Xbox. So anyways, sorry, Ka, go ahead.
No. You leaned right into the parts of the conversation that I was going to jump into too. I think the thing that I have the most frustration with is when I'm talking to fans out in the Twitterverse and social media is that the idea of Xbox lied about what their hardware can do. And I think that there's a conversation there that needs to be rehad about what do we mean by next generation hardware? What do we mean by next generation gaming? I think the ideas that were put out there around ray tracing and 120 hertz and speed that you'll get off the SSD and all of those interconnected things that make up your experience, there's a big difference between what the aspirational work of hardware can do and what winds up happening when developers have to make games for what that aspirational hardware is. When you're getting that initial understanding of what that's going to be as a developer from conversations I've had, is that you get a spec and you figure out what that spec is going to be, and then you kind of work towards as much as you can for that spec. You see that get a lot easier towards the end of a generation, like we've talked about, but also from the player perspective. And this is maybe where marketing kind of oversteps its bounds, is there is a little bit of, we are thinking about the future of games and we may not get there in the generation that we're in, but you will get some of the kind of features that will go alongside that experience. So it winds up being a really difficult conversation to really parse out if you are a person who is not super learned about the space or understand the technology in those ways, where we didn't really get a full understanding and a full definition of what the expectation for next-gen gaming was going to be. And now we're figuring that stuff out in real time while the games are coming out. So I think there's a good balance there. And I think Phil did a really good job there of talking about where we're at now. But I think that that definition of where we are from a technology standpoint is going to continue to evolve throughout the next parts of this generation. Does that come in the next-gen refresh? I hope not. Does that come at the end of the generation? We'll probably see that happen.
I'll put it to each of you here. Do you want to see a mid-gen refresh, let's say in the next 2 years? Either holiday 24 or holiday 25. Would you be interested in a higher power, you know, more throw some more teraflops, you know, throw a revision of the Series X out there? Would that be of interest to you, Stella? Would you pay for that?
No.
Khalid?
No.
So I'm the only one, because I'm a big yes.
Okay.
And I'll tell you why. I think it's probably fair to say I don't have the data. Microsoft does. Next time I get a chance to ask the right person, I will ask them, because maybe at this point they'd be willing to share, since it's far enough in the past. I would be willing to wager that the Xbox One X, you know, of course, it came out at a higher price point, and I suspect that basically was only sold to enthusiasts. I would suspect that 1 out of 10 Xbox One consoles sold was probably a One X, and that's not, I'm not disparaging the One X. I'm just, mm-hmm. That's probably the reality that how many people in your potential pool of customers are going to be willing to spend more for that, at the time, 4K gaming experience versus the number of people that are going to spend 2/3 of that or half of that just buy the regular Xbox One S and have a nice, 1080p gaming experience, which all the games fully support. And I think that would be the case again, particularly as, like we were saying, these consoles are not going down in price. We're just about 3 years in. There's no even, I don't think any of us are even remotely expecting a price drop anytime soon, given that we had price increases in various territories. But I'm still like, I know that I could just upgrade my PC and that PC gaming is a way to go, and Xbox fully supports that. And I'm staring at a decent PC here. My camera sits on top of my PC, and it's okay. But I also don't super enjoy the sort of the nuance of PC gaming, meaning the like getting everything installed right and swapping out components. It's a lot of people love that. I can do it. I have done it. I don't super enjoy it. I would be one that if you said, all right, there's a $650 mid-gen, let's just call it a Series X Pro because Series XX sounds ridiculous. if I would pay $650 for a Series X Pro that could give me consistent 4K 60 frame rates on pretty much everything, or in some cases, Stella, 120 frames for certain games, and that, you know, could offer other benefits. I would be willing to do that because I'm a hardcore enough gamer that prefers gaming on my Xbox that I would do it. But I think it would be interesting to poll our larger audience to see, because we've got two of you that said no, you're not even super interested in a mid-gen, and just one of us saying yes. I think if Destin were here, he would say yes, but I can't.
I think he would say yes too.
I think, yeah,
because he's such a tech-oriented guy. But yeah, it is. I guess the kind of ultimate point of this is that there's a lot of uncertainty around this now, where after the One X and the PS4 Pro last gen, I think everybody kind of, I don't think I was the only one that felt like that was going to be business as usual from now on, that it was going to be that smartphone, like, you know, more frequent iteration on this stuff. But maybe, you know, this gen for various reasons is not going to be like that.
Silicon is still hard to come by. Like, even if you think about the nuts and bolts of building these machines, it's still a deficit in terms of where that is. So even if we wanted it, we might not even have the resources to do it. We might have to go in to the trade center, like in Starfield, and go
buy some
aluminum and get some stuff to get some silicon and get it out of there, because it's not on the planet that we're on right now. But I feel you on that. I think Destin would definitely say yeah. He would.
Yeah.
I think so.
It's just like Ka said, it's just like, will the developers have an easier time adapting their games to fit that platform? Because they only now are adjusting to this now. So it's like 2 years, okay, yeah, sure, everything's back in motion, but I don't know if 2 years is enough, right? Maybe longer, but I don't know. It's like, I feel like we're just catching up. So that's why I'm a no, because I don't think that a refresh could do anything more for developers to actually make those games at their height, like the highest optimized for that platform. So
I would respectfully disagree, even though neither one of us is a game developer, so yeah. We don't really have a leg to stand on here, but only because, you know, the One X started this, and now we are seeing it more regularly on the Series X and because of the Series S as well, where developers are starting to normalize various different graphic settings on console, which of course has been a thing on PC forever. But, you know, we're really starting to see now whether you want quality mode, performance ray tracing mode, pure performance mode. And so I am confident, without being a game developer, that if there were a Series X Pro, if there were that higher spec machine, that they would be able to offer value to gamers at a relatively low cost to the developer, in terms of having to, you know, put in a bunch more development support to, like, I think if you just throw a bunch more horsepower, that the games are now flexible enough because they're designed to work across so many different configurations, that I am confident that we would see results out of games on a mid-gen refresh.
I was going to say something about DLSS, but that's not on the Xbox platform because they run AMD chips. Anyway,
right.
Never mind. I was going to say that would have been cool to see.
But I like where your head's at. Yeah.
I mean, but that could be a thing, right? We're seeing a lot of graphical emulation in that spot where they're doubling pixels and doing pixel generation and stuff too. Maybe there is something in that mix that works on console at some point down the line that helps.
I think the game to test it with would probably be Jedi Survivor, because they just had a patch out and it still doesn't fix the issue. It fixed like 70% of the issues on console, but it's still not where it should be.
Yeah.
And it sucks because it's a good game, but
it's a great game.
People just can't play it, especially on console, which is
Did you see, I finished it on Series X and I didn't really have a, like, it didn't run. It wasn't like this, you know,
right,
60 frames per second buttery, but I enjoyed the hell out of it. Like, that game will make, will almost certainly be on my personal shortlist for Game of the Year.
Okay.
And yeah, I would certainly recommend to any Series X owner that they play that game right now. I played it before this latest big old patch that they put out. So, I mean, I get where you're coming from totally, Stella, but I don't know. I feel like Jedi Survivors, it's a totally playable game you're not gonna be like, oh man, this would be so good if only the frame rate were a bit better. Like, no, it's really good as it is.
Oh, okay, interesting. I've heard the opposite from other people who are playing on consoles. So I played a PC, so I can't speak to the console experience. PC, it's great, but like I definitely still notice when there are slight drops. I have a monster PC, so like I ran into very little bugs even before all the updates and everything, which is great. Mm-hmm. I made the mistake of playing it on the highest difficulty, where I do feel like it is less optimized for very specific and accurate moves and blocks and parries and all the higher skilled things that you need to be able to do to survive in the higher difficulty. So in terms of that, I feel like they just did not do a great job of really fine tuning their mechanics, and the bits of jank that you do run into are very apparent due to that. So
Before we move on to the next topic, because there's more, but there's one more thing on this that I think bears circling back to, and I forget which one of you said it. I think it was Stella, that you were talking about how, you know, we're really kind of only now getting fully into this generation. And Khalif, help me remember. So when we went from 360 to Xbox One, there was sort of that transition period early in that Xbox One generation where we did get a decent number of remasters and kind of reissues of things at higher resolutions, frame rates. I feel like Capcom was really guilty of that in the early part of that generation. There were a lot of kind of, just like not Game of the Year editions, but just sort of, you know, reissues of things on the newer hardware.
Right.
And here's the part where I need some help remembering. I still feel like we generally got on with the Xbox One generation reasonably quickly. Or at least I'll say, for context, quicker than we have this time. Like, I feel like, I agree with what you said, Stella. I do feel like, not that we haven't gotten some really great games this generation, I'm not saying that, but I do feel like, technologically speaking, we've had a ton of remasters and re-releases of things, and just cross-gen releases where we haven't, like, we're only just now starting to finally get Series X releases and moving on from the Xbox One. Khalif, am I remembering this correctly? Do you think has it been a sort of, a for lack of a better term, a longer generational transition this time than it was last time?
It feels like that. And I think even if you really dig back into like the zeitgeist of that era, it was really during that era is where we saw a lot of conversation from the PC side grow in a much bigger way too, where it was about what GPU were you running. Oh my God, those folks over there who are playing PC are playing at this resolution and this frame rate. Man, consoles are really struggling at this point to be able to get to any of that. So it winds up feeling like a lot of that kind of hurry up and go wind up moving the Xbox One generation a lot faster to get to a space that was more in line and had a little bit more parity with what PC players are having, because they were, to be honest, and still are, and they probably will forever because of the way it all works, will have better experiences from a fidelity and frame rate perspective, because you have those abilities to swap out pieces and components and do that work with, as opposed to a closed system like a console. So it winds up being that now, where there's gotten a little bit closer, we're seeing that kind of information transfer happen. We're seeing that kind of conversation about like, oh, I can play this game on my Xbox Series X or my PlayStation 5 and feel like I'm having a almost similar experience to what's happening on the PC side. So I think that that energy in the room that was there during the Xbox Series 1 layer, I think that definitely shortened up that time frame, because it was a thing that the audience was asking for too. It was like, why don't we have that experience that all our PC friends are having in the games that they're playing? So yeah, I think you're right about that for sure. I think it did shorten it up a bit.
And I guess, Stella, it's we probably have the business side of the game industry to thank in large part for this, because the publishers don't want to leave the Xbox One and PS4 behind, because the PS4 was wildly successful and the Xbox One was no slouch itself. So they've, you know, I think maybe there have been business reasons why we've had to wait for this new generation to properly take hold as well, right?
I would assume so, yeah. I mean, the Xbox One, so that was my first console that I owned myself, that I didn't borrow or, like, you know, do any of that stuff on. So I remember, and I came in through it about mid-generation, I think. So I remember using it and I was like, oh my God, this is awesome. Like, this is easy. I also used the, God, this is, I know people are going to be like, oh, this is very different from what you usually play, but I used the Kinect for Just Dance and everything. It was great. Sure. It was like the best technology for that, right?
Dance
and I was
like, Central's, oh my God, where it's at.
Is it? Oh, yeah. Yeah. I thought about getting a 360 just to play Dance Central because I did not get to play it, and it looks so fun. They have better music. Anyways, I do remember that being like the platform. I was like, this is awesome. I can finally play with everyone. I can kind of expect the same quality across all the different games that I bought. And it's so interesting that coming to the Series X, we're just like, it's the first like birth of a platform that I'm seeing for a major, like for Xbox, right?
Yeah.
Where I'm actively part of the industry. I'm part of the gaming community and also the industry. So I'm just like, oh, I'm seeing all of these new things. So it's very interesting. And then also COVID hit. So it's a very unique situation. So and of course, even then there were like business decisions they had to make about like, oh my God, what do we do with the manufacturers? What do we do with this? So I definitely think it was not just one thing that kept the Series X and S from really blossoming as soon as it launched.
So we'll see. I should throw up, maybe after this episode publishes, I'll put a poll on my Twitter.
Ooh,
to see,
yeah,
see what people, yeah, are. Just take the temperature of the unlocked audience, because I'm kind of curious, since we have we've absentee voted for Destin and decided that he would vote my way, and that which splits us to, you know, even right down the middle. So we will see how everybody else is kind of feeling about a mid-gen refresh, but Phil Spencer definitely keeping it at arm's length at best for now. But what we're hoping to get moved a little closer to Xbox, meaning onto the Xbox, are Final Fantasy games. So Destin also asked Phil about Final Fantasy 16 and Final Fantasy 7 Remake, now that we have finally gotten the announcement that Final Fantasy 14, the wonderful MMORPG, will be coming to Xbox. And Phil said in response, quote, "I recognize that when people buy an Xbox, they want to make sure the great games that they want to play are coming. If there's any publisher out there where that hasn't been true, Square's one of the top. Sarah Bond, the corporate VP of Game Creator Experience and Ecosystem at Microsoft, Sarah and I fly to Tokyo to have conversations, and we've spent a lot of time with Square. There's obviously business deals and relationships that we'll have to get worked through on certain games. But I'll say it was really great to have the CEO of Square and Yoshi-san there to talk about their commitment to Xbox." He's referring to the Final Fantasy XIV announcement. "Because I can say, like, I'm the head of Xbox, blah, 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 but having the CEO of one of the third parties make a commitment to the platform, I thought that was a really meaningful step. So you'll hear more. I'm not going to push them. They're going to have to find their own rhythm. But having them make a commitment to Xbox," meaning again with Final Fantasy XIV, "was really important both to me, and I've heard it from the community, to the community as well. And 14 was more of a commitment." So again, kind of a non-answer. He didn't directly speak to 7 Remake or 16, But I think again, I speak Phil, and what I would translate that to is, we've broken the ice with these guys. We've gotten the dialogue started. So there's some optimism that future Final Fantasy games, whether it's 16 or maybe it's just 17 down the road, and we'll, you know, who knows, we'll see about FF7 remake, but it sounds like the initial ice has been broken, and the conversations are there. Stellar, are you optimistic that future Final Fantasies will follow here after this Final Fantasy 14 announcement?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, 14 is huge. Like, that was the first MMORPG that I got into consistently for a while. I just could not keep up with the each expansion, so I did end up canceling my subscription. But this is huge for them. I mean, this is the MMORPG that everyone is really into, and it's very easy to retain people as well, because you have that free trial that lasts for like expansions upon expansions, and it's crazy. So I definitely think that's going to open up a huge audience that are going to be like, okay, well, you have 14. I'm hungry for more. You got any more of that Final Fantasy? Come on, Xbox, you know? So I think that's definitely going to create a demand on the platform, and I'm very happy for Final Fantasy fans.
Yeah, I'm optimistic as well. I don't necessarily think it'll be either 16 or remake. I think there's the better chance would be for future Final Fantasy games to hopefully be day and date on Xbox, which they have been before, and hopefully we'll get back to again. There's time for one more story before we do trivia. And I hate to end on a down note. I mean, I guess trivia will be fun. This next story is not, but it absolutely is worth talking about here. And that is some sad news and bad news. The developer of Saints Row and Red Faction, among other games, Volition has announced that its parent company, the Embracer Group, is shutting Volition down. In an update on LinkedIn, the studio wrote, "This past June, Embracer Group announced a restructuring program to strengthen Embracer and maintain its position as a leader in the video game industry. As part of that program, they evaluated strategic and operational goals and made the difficult decision to close Volition effective immediately. To help our team, we are working to provide job assistance and help smooth the transition for our Volition family members. We thank our customers and fans around the world for all the love and support over the years. You will always be in our hearts." Khalif, just because you're a fellow old like me, you've probably played, you've been around a while, and have probably played a lot of their games over the years. I want to go to you first here. Your maybe just fondest memories of this studio's games, because they made a bunch of good ones.
I mean, of course, the early, you know, Saints Row games were revolutionary for their time, and I was a huge Red Factions fan. So sad that that they're gone, and now, you know, what does this mean for Embracer? It feels like Embracer now is like the Madden curse of publishers at this point, where as soon as you see their name on something, you're like, somebody's about to get hurt. I don't know who it's going to be, but somebody's going to get hurt now. So massive love to the folks over at Volition, because they put out so many dope games over the years. So sad to hear this.
Favorite? Want to pick one, either of whether it's Red Faction or Saints Row or even one of their older games? Does one stand out for you as your favorite Volition game ever?
That first Red Faction game, like that game was revolutionary to me. I was just like, technology. I can do what? Yeah, yeah. I was like, I can do you, what? I can do
you
that.
Can actually, I can destroy the environment. Yeah, that had never been done before.
So good. So yeah, Red Faction, rest in peace too.
Stella, I don't know how many of their games you may have played in more recent years, but your thoughts here on Volition's unfortunate closure.
Yeah, I was looking at their site, and they just celebrated 30 years, and I'm like, oh my god, dude, this sucks. And yeah, I'm actually trying to see which Saints Row. Saints Row 4, I think, was the one that I played. Yes. I loved Saints Row. I could do so much in it. And I remember making just the most ridiculous character, and my friend made an even more ridiculous character, and you could just get away with so much. There was so much in the game. I don't don't even think I can talk about it here because I feel like there are a lot of censored things that you can do in that game. I loved the freedom of that, and it was just so fun playing with my friend. So I'm very sad about this. I didn't get to play the latest Saints Row, the reboot that came out, but it does suck that they weren't able to continue making more games, and especially after the 30-year thing. I'm reading their post about it, and it's such a like lovely, heartfelt letter to the community. They're talking about this landmark anniversary, and they're still very proud of their studio, and they can't wait to move forward. And they said, "Here's to the next chapter," and it just breaks my heart seeing that.
Yeah, just hearts go out to everybody at Volition. Thank you for all the awesome games over the years. You know, it's just that corporate awfulness at work where you have this studio that's done so much great stuff over 30 years, but we live in such a, not just numbers driven, but also we live in a, what have you done for me lately kind of corporate environment where the Saints Row reboot didn't work. Agents of Mayhem before that, which was this sort of weird Saints Row but not Saints Row game, that didn't really work. So, you know, the last two games, which kind of amounts to the last 5, 6, 7 years of the studio, doesn't work. And so when Volition's looking to make some cuts to save some money, it's unfortunate that Volition becomes the one that gets shut down. So really sad to see that. And yeah, hopefully everybody affected is able to find an awesome next chapter of their video game career. All right. Well, I've already gone way over again. I guess we'll save trivia till next time, because otherwise I'm going to get yelled at for going way over our allotted time this week. So,
oh, I thought you were going to get yelled at by Destin for doing it without him. But yeah,
Destin will be thanking me for not doing trivia. He'll be happy that we ran out of time. But
yes,
Khalif, we love you. Where should everybody be listening to you, watching you, following you?
Check out Spawn on Me every Monday. They drop. We had to move it this week because of some embargoed conversations, but you can find it on all podcast platforms. YouTube and twitch.tv/SpawnOnMe is where you can go check us out every Wednesday evening around 6 p.m. To go see the live show.
Brilliant. Stella?
Yeah, at Parallax Stella everywhere, except for Instagram, where it is parallaxstella.official. I am gearing up towards my October powerlifting meet. So you're going to be seeing a lot of training videos for that. But also in the meantime on IGN, I'm going to be helping out with guides content for Starfield. So you can look out for that. And on my personal stream, I am playing a lot of Baldur's Gate. So if you want to see more horny stuff, that is where you can go.
Well, that's quite a message to close on. That's probably the single best plug you could have possibly given to your channel right there. I'm not sure that you could top that ever, but I'm on Twitter. There's no horny content on it, but if you do want to follow me on Twitter, it's DMC_Ryan. So for our awesome producer, Red, along with Khalif Adams and Stella Chung, I'm Ryan McCaffrey. This was Podcast Unlocked 611. Into the Starfield I go. Now that we're done with this show, I'm gonna get back to it here. We'll see you guys next week.